Monday, May 10th, 1886, the Detroit Wolverines surprised the National League favorite New York Giants 9-2 in Detroit. Senator John Sherman of Ohio, brother of General William Tecumseh Sherman, celebrated his 63rd birthday, and the Supreme Court of the United States issued its ruling in a little number we call Santa Clara County v. Southern Pacific Railroad Company. That affirmed that corporations were kind of like real people. You couldn't tax them in ways that you couldn't tax real people, but of course, you also couldn't send them to jail for anything, and they could be immortal. And in our third story tonight, the ruling also ultimately gave filmmaker Michael Moore his latest topic, and it gave our country 123 years of the hell on earth that is the legally sanctioned greedy vampire. The mere audacity of Mr. Moore exploring an issue is grist for controversy always, but what you probably will not hear about the film Capitalism from its fiercest detractors is that it was produced in Traverse City, a small town in Moore's beloved state, the state which still has the nation's highest unemployment rate, more than 15%. So Moore is looking through that window when he takes aim at policies that have largely benefited the richest 1% of our populace. The former Republican governor of Michigan, William Milliken, who attended one of the Michigan premieres of the film, said, quote, "The message of the injustices that still persist and prevail in our society, that's a powerful message." As always, in Michael's documentaries, he attempts to explain the treacherous with dark comic frankness.
The scam to swindle people out of the homes they already owned was masterful. Here's how it worked. First, tell these homeowners that they own a bank, and that bank is your home. So if your home is worth $250,000, that makes you a quarter millionaire. You're sitting on a gold mine. You own your own bank, the bank of you. And you can use your bank to get more money. Just refinance. Everyone's doing it. Of course, hidden in the dozens or hundreds of pages of fine print are tricky clauses that allow the bank to raise your interest rate to a number you didn't know about, perhaps so high that you won't be able to repay your loan. But that's okay. If you can't repay it, we'll just take your house.
Joining me now, as promised, Michael Moore, whose new documentary, Capitalism, A Love Story, opens nationwide next Friday. Welcome.
Thank you for having me here.
Pleasure.
Great to meet you.
The mess that was exposed beginning a year ago, basically this week, and which has become more shocking by the day as we have realized what we funneled all this money into. Was it sadly inevitable, or were there other ways to deal with it by the time it hit the tipping point?
No, it was always going to happen, because we actually started on this path about 30 years ago with the election of Ronald Reagan. And Reagan and his people, Don Regan in particular, his Secretary of Treasury, who happened to be the chairman of Merrill Lynch at the time, they decided that the way for them to get even more filthy rich than they already were was to throw as many people out of work as they possibly could. They still got to keep the company running. They still got to make the cars. They got to sell. But let's see if we could, say, get rid of half the workforce and have the remaining half work twice as hard. Don't give them any raise in their wages. And think of the money we're going to make. And that was the plan. And for a while, it worked. Because for short-term gain, you get rid of people. I mean, your bottom line is going to immediately look better, because that's your biggest expense. But what it did in the long run is it decimated the middle class. And they killed the very people that were supposed to buy their cars or their TVs or washing machines or whatever was being built. And we stopped making things in this country. And we turned it over to a bunch of really psychotic people who had these crazy schemes about how to create virtual casinos down on Wall Street, take people's pensions and their 401ks, create betting schemes where they would take out a bet against, then they would bet against the bet, then take out an insurance policy against both bets. It was just absolutely, absolutely crazy, insane, and it has almost wrecked us.
The statement a year ago at this time was, if we did not intervene, if we did not pour in as much money that was necessary for the banks, then the insurance industries, and then everything else, if we didn't give that money, it meant another Great Depression. In retrospect, was there any truth to that?
Well, we'll never know.
Yeah.
But they are masters at manipulating the fear in people. I mean, everyone had to act right away. We couldn't have any hearings. We couldn't, don't even read the bill.
Yeah. Well, first off, it's written on the back of somebody's cocktail
napkin. Like, right, it's like 2.5 pages long, about $1 billion a word. Don't read the bill, just pass it. And I mean, these guys are, boy, they're great at what they do. And it was almost a replay, because here it was 6 weeks, 8 weeks before the election, you know, go back to 2002, mm-hmm. 6-8 weeks before the election, mushroom clouds, missiles hitting London, et cetera, et cetera. You know, steel rods, balloons.
Gliders that could make it here from Baghdad. You know. Don't forget the gliders.
Right.
And the trailer and the trailers that were full of of latrines. As
all
it turned
that
out.
Stuff, mm-hmm. you know, to get everybody all like this and to do it to Congress before they're up for re-election. And make them afraid that if they vote against this,
yes.
then they're for Saddam.
Right.
And so now flip ahead to 2008. If you don't vote for this bailout, you're against the American people. You want to destroy the teachers' pension fund. I mean, if they really, this is what bugs me, Keith, is they actually are smarter than you and I.
Yeah.
They pull this stuff off, and they get away with it. They get away with murder. And here we are a year later. Remember that first few weeks? Oh, what we need are more regulations. Just get the rules back in place, and we'll be okay. So here we are a year later.
Nothing.
Where's the rules? Where's it there? And let me tell you something. A year from now, won't be anything either.
Exactly.
Until the people at home decide to say, that's it.
All right, now is that still capable of happening? Because as I mentioned, it's 1886 since the Santa Clara decision, which changed, I mean, it created these sort of semi-humans. Has there ever been a real chance to get control of the nation back from the corporations after that point?
Well, there have been attempts to do that, but of course, especially with the conservative court of recent years, they want to protect the rights of these corporations. They believe that money equals free speech. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a case that they're going to decide this year that I got kind of wrangled into because of this anti-Hillary movie that was made as
right.
an ad. Saying, well, Michael Moore gets to make Fahrenheit 9/11. Of course, that's actually a movie that wins the Palme d'Or, and you know, my films are actually...
It's a movie.
And I don't work for the Democratic
right.
Party.
Yeah, it's a movie.
It's an actual movie.
Yes.
It's not an ad. But the Supreme Court may rule in favor of these corporations, may be able to not have to follow the election laws and do things like that business did.
Is the one saving grace in the corporate system, we were talking about this before, was that the reason you can make your films is the reason I can do my show without being, you know, thrown out of the windows up there.
Right.
The corporation is not necessarily immoral, it's amoral. If you make
That's
it
correct.
Money,
yeah.
most of the time it will let you do whatever it is built in to sustain itself, even when we're at our doing whatever it is we do best, correct?
Right. Because the corporation is obviously it's just in the business of making money, and it doesn't really matter how it makes it. This is why I say capitalism is such an immoral system, mm-hmm. because it is only about making the money. But you and I are because of that crack in the system that allows even us to do this because we make the money. Trust me, if we didn't make the money, that'd be the last you'd hear from
that's
us.
It, right. Good night, everybody. Yeah.
But here's the thing though. This is when they'll stop putting you on the air and when they'll stop distributing my movies. If people after they get done watching Countdown each night, or after they leave the movie theater for my movie, if they actually get up off the couch, get out of that theater seat and do something, if your bosses at GE or my distributor at Viacom mm-hmm. and Liberty Media decides that, oh my God, look what happened. We put this movie in theaters and now the people are revolting and our lobbyists aren't getting their way in Congress. The representatives are actually doing what the people want. That's when they're going to maybe say, okay, this is a mistake. So my appeal to the viewers is put Keith and me out of business.
Exactly. I'm just going to say, you're willing to make that trade?
Absolutely. Oh,
me
my
too.
God. Yes,
me
sir.
Too.
Let's go fishing.
That's it. And then we can exactly go to a ball game. Michael Moore's movie is Capitalism, A Love Story. Great luck with it. A pleasure to meet you.
Likewise.
You have done great work for this country, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for being here every night.
And thank you for being here this night.